How you doing, Dave?
Hello.
I don't think you can get out now.
Thank you.
Wait a minute, Brian and I have a Hey, that does that fit better?
Yeah. Don't tell my wife that I hugged that on.
Why?
She won't never do the dishes.
Yeah.
If she don't know, won't hurt her.
I won't tell her a thing.
I can answer that.
Wonder what this is set up for.
Well, they were taking pictures. That might be standing right in front of the camera. You know, I didn't think about that.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to our Easter sunrise service this morning on this beautiful Easter morning. I would like to apologize to those of you who asked me what radio station we were broadcasting on. For those of you who wish to stay in your cars, we never seem to resolve that until the last minute on Easter Sunday morning, but it's FM 94.1 and AM 1300 if you happen to be listening on the radio. We'd also like to thank Explore Clarion for live streaming this morning. We'd like to express our thanks to the fire police this morning for helping us in directing traffic. We would like to thank the many sponsors that are listed on the back of your program. Also, Boy Scout Troop 51 for assisting us with the flag presentation this morning. And we would like to thank our many participants. And most of all, we thank you for coming out this morning to enjoy our presentation. So, again, thank you all for coming out and spending your time with us on this beautiful morning.
If everyone can please stand with us as we sing together, Love Run Red. The lyrics are in the program.
Reigns and never dies.
streams of grace flow deep and wide. Of all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. Victory in my Savior's loss, and the crimson flowing from the cross pour over me, pour over me. Yes, oh, let this be where I die. My Lord, with Thee crucified and be lifted high as my kingdom's fall once and for all. To lay it down, oh Lord, I lay it down. Help me to lay it down, oh Lord, I lay it down. So let this be. Crucified. can be lifted high. It's my kingdom small, once and for all. Once and for all.
crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, did you forget me, Father, did you? They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Christ our Lord has risen. Alleluia. He has risen indeed, and we are here today to celebrate because a joy has come over our lives, because hope has been restored and death defeated. This is the day that we offer ourselves because Christ Jesus has risen from the grave. Alleluia. Before I give my invocation and read the scripture, I got to tell you, yesterday we had an Easter egg hunt at my church, and one of the director's grandchildren was there, plus some other folks, and I was complaining. I said, last year I preached this, and it was snowing, and it was cold, and not too many people showed up. And I said, my wife's getting good weather tomorrow. That's not fair. And that little grandson of his, I'm not sure exactly how old, 5, 6, 7, somewhere in that range, 4. Oh my gosh. I didn't. Said, well, that's how God designed it. From the mouths of babes. Amen. Let us pray. God of new life, you have brought your kingdom and reign into this tarred and dry world through the resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Hear our cry for help. Restore us so that we might be saved in your restoring love. Stay near to us when we wander from you, and guide us safely with your mysterious love, and guide us into the loving arms of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. And all God's children said, amen. Our scripture lesson today comes out of the Gospel of John. This is chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Are you ready to hear the word to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings laying there and the cloth that was on Jesus' head. Well, that was lying with the rolling wrappings and rolled up in a separate place. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and he believed. For as of yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes, but Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over and looked into the tomb, and there she saw two angels in white sitting there where Jesus' body had been laying, one at the head and the other angel at the feet. They said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for? Supposing he was a gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him in Hebrew, Rabboni, which means teacher. Jesus said to her, do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them the things that he had said to her. This is the word of the Lord.
The stone was gone, so Mary assumed that Christ had been taken away. The tomb was empty, and so Peter assumed that Christ had been taken away. The angels came, so Mary assumed that Christ had been taken away. The linens were discarded, so Peter assumed that Christ had been taken away. And yet, Christ was risen. Christ was alive. Christ was in their midst. They saw the living Christ. When our lives seem empty, we assume that Christ has been taken away. When our lives are full of pain, we assume that Christ has been taken away. And yet, Christ is risen. Christ is alive. Christ is in our midst. Let us open our eyes to see the living Christ here with us today. What a beautiful morning, just like last year. But the weather is a little bit different. Both mornings share the same beauty as every Easter morning for these nearly 2,000 years. The beauty of knowing that death could not hold our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Come on, I want you to say it with me. It's okay, we're outside. We can use our outside voices. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. This is a day for shouting and singing and making a joyful noise. So church, you and me out here in the world, we cannot, we will not be silent. He lives. He lives, he lives. You can sing if you know it. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives. Did you know that we're making history together today? I alluded to that earlier. It's been nearly 2,000 years of celebrating Easter morning, 1,993 years. Now, this sunrise service has been part of the history of this local area for 73 years. I don't know if you noticed that in your bulletin today. And I'm honored to be with you making history here today. I'm one of millions of pastors throughout the world today on this 1,993rd Easter morning who has the privilege of once again declaring to the people of God the good news about the love and grace of Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose again and is coming back, by the way. Don't forget. Hallelujah. It's good to be with you today, to have this great opportunity to share with you this miracle, this mystery, this incredible news that Christ is risen and is coming again. But wait a minute. Really, let's be real. How do we know that Christ is risen? We just sang about it. We know it in our heart. But how do we keep the faith and hope that and know that it's true? We didn't see it, right? We've only read and heard about it. None of us here was there that morning. Well, maybe some of us, like Pastor Rick over there, are close to old enough that it might have been possible. I guess no Easter ham for me today. But it's not likely. Yet here we are this morning, bright and early, well, early anyway, to celebrate and worship this one that somehow we have come to know and has changed our lives completely. Now, I realize that may not be true for everyone here today, not yet. Maybe some have questions for and came here knowing, wanting to know this Jesus that we speak of today, this Christ who is risen. So how do we know? It really is a good question, I think. It's a question that for those who have this hope and faith inside us that we ought to always be ready to give an answer for, right? In 1 Peter, it tells us there to always be ready to make a defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting of the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and reverence. So are we ready? How do we know that Christ is risen? For folks who know Christ, who have accepted his love and grace, who gather to worship and study together and have built a relationship with him, we do have a few ways to know. And a primary way is through God's word. In God's word from the Old Testament to the New, there are patterns, there are similarities in the way that God relates with us that we can learn to recognize, so that we might know the reality of God's promises fulfilled in the risen Christ. We see those ways and patterns at work in the story that we heard Pastor Rick read about Mary in the garden on that first resurrection morning. There was a lot of activity and confusion that morning. It's not so hard to imagine. Fear and grief had scattered Jesus' followers apart. They were afraid and disoriented, struggling to remember what they were once so sure of, that is, God's love and presence with them. What were they supposed to do? Crazed with grief for their beloved friend and teacher, the Messiah. What was it exactly? All that stuff he kept trying to tell them about this day. Who could remember? With that image of him bloodied and tortured and hanging on the cross and dying right before their eyes, that was so fresh in their minds on that morning as they searched for him. Perhaps they had already begun to doubt their identities as God's beloved children with a purpose to live out for God. Maybe we easily see ourselves in that place today. The women went early in the morning to care for Jesus' body. It was something that they could do, something that they knew how to do, a small comfort in this moment. But after that, how did they know? In the stories of the women that morning, as reported in the four Gospels, there are ways that they came to know what Jesus said is true, and we can follow that pattern. In Luke, they knew that Christ had risen and what they were to do because angels appeared to them and reminded them. It says there, remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and on the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all of this to the 11 and to all the rest. In Matthew, they, and in particular Mary Magdalene, being among the first at the tomb, knew he had risen because a dazzling white man met them saying, he is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. And then the angel invited them to come and see the place where he lay. And then the angel gave them instructions and a purpose, saying, then go quickly and tell his disciples he's been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him. This is my message for you. And finally, on the way to fulfilling this purpose, in Matthew it says that suddenly Jesus met them and said, greetings, and they came to him and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee and they will see me. Do you notice the pattern? Angels appearing, saying, do not be afraid, reminding them of God's words, of Christ's words to them, but especially the presence and personal touch of a Savior who was with them in the moment of their terror, which soon turned to joy. We've seen this before in other stories about Jesus' birth, for example. We see it in John's account of that resurrection morning. Mary is at first unable to recognize Jesus. She comes to know it's him and that the promise that he made to return and rise again is true because he first calls her by name. He gives her a personal word unique and special for her. How wonderful to know that our God recognizes us. She recognizes the voice of her teacher, the one that she has followed, who was present and is now present with her in her fear and in her grief, and she receives then a personal touch from Christ. Jesus comforts her, calls her by name, and then extends an invitation to a particular purpose. He says to Mary, "Go and tell my brothers and say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." This would be the first personal word and the way that they would come to know that Christ is risen when Mary told them. In the upper room and on the road to Emmaus, the rest of disciples would soon also know this pattern, that they could be sure that Jesus Christ had risen. That's how they knew. But how do we know? As personal as the resurrection experience described in John's gospel is for Mary, the awe of a resurrection truth and the reality of a risen Savior for all of us is also there to know. The first thing the women noticed, that huge stone that had sealed the tomb had been rolled aside like that temple curtain that was torn. When Jesus died on the cross, though Jesus' death and resurrection through Jesus' death and resurrection, all obstacles to access God's presence are removed. We can know and claim for ourselves the power of recognition and restoration in Jesus' calling of Mary's name, a name that meant obstinate, rebellious, but also love. Humanity's stubbornness and rebellion is met in the garden that morning with the love of God, who always recognizes us, each one by name, and loves us even in our rebellious state. God never stops reaching toward us. The first encounter of the risen Lord occurs in a garden to a woman that Jesus had driven demons out of. God's love had met her in power and in glory. Christ promises to be with us when evil attacks us and invades our spirits. A United Methodist pastor named Kimberly Constant writes about this garden encounter with the risen Christ, saying this: "It was a moment which brought restoration to all of humanity, but also in a particular way to women who for thousands of years had carried the weight of Eve's actions first to fall prey to the temptation of the tree and the lies of the enemy in another garden long ago." What a hopeful encounter now, reconciling that. And it has eternal implications. And that is how we know, isn't it? We come seeking recognition, to be known and loved by God and to know God more and more. We come here to celebrate this morning, to worship, to give thanks, and to be reminded of God's word of hope, to be surprised by the depth of God's love for us that never lets us go, to know that it is true that we are never too gone to receive that love, to know it is true that Christ is risen. We know somewhere along the way, God has met each one of us with a personal word, calling our name, with a personal touch, and then a personal invitation to come and see, and then to go and tell. We know from eyewitnesses that Jesus' resurrection body is real too. It can be touched. He can touch us. Jesus shows us the reality of God's promises that hold us before we can grab hold of him. And we know this because someone came and told us. Someone shared this good news with us. They gave us a reason for their hope in God, and we were personally touched by Christ through them. Someone showed us what God's love and grace looks like. We grabbed hold of the Savior's feet, and our heart experienced his grace and love personally. So now we know, perhaps for the first time today, or maybe with a renewed spirit for the 50th time. So now we know, but what are we going to do about it? That's an even better question. I hear every day how we need a revival in this dark world of ours. Amen? And I'm here to testify that's true. But it's also true that it isn't going to start out there in the world. People of God, it begins right here with us who know that Christ is risen. In the hearts of the people of God who are gathered into this body called the church, because we do know that Christ is risen. We know because he lives in our hearts. It's what we say we know, anyway. If we're too timid to shout it from the rooftops with our outside voices, who's going to do it? Evil gets a foothold because good people refuse to speak and to stand and give an answer for the hope in the risen Christ that we know. Jesus' 40-day journey in the wilderness makes it clear that evil does require a response. And in the power of Christ, the people of God can give it. Jesus never backed down from an attack. And people, we are in a war. If anyone's going to know the good news, it's going to come from the ones who claim to know Christ. Do you? Do you know him? Of his love for you? Do you know that he's risen and he's coming again? Do you know? Because we Christians have been pretty quiet about it for, the last 50 years or so. If revival is coming, and it's coming, that needs to change. Let it begin with us. The Apostle Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 10, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed?" Do you believe? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? Have you told anyone about him? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? I'm afraid, my friends, that shoe fits a little too well for us. But even in our failure, even when we forget to tell somebody about Jesus sometimes, our hope is in the risen Christ because he is holding us. And through even our failures and faults, he can be known. So have you believed our message? Do you know and believe in the one, the author of our salvation and lover of our souls? If you want to know him and you don't know him yet, ask right now, pray right now for God to open your heart and to make you new or to renew you. A lot of people here right now would be happy to pray with you. You can come now if you want to know this greatest love and hope of Christ. We'll pray with you and praise God with you. And so now we know, and we each have a unique purpose given to us in some way. We've got to go now and to tell it with not only our words, but with our actions. The world that is losing hope, and it is losing hope, needs to know the reason for our hope. Not the ravings of condemnation, but remembering in the way that the good news came to us in relationship with Christ, with gentleness and reverence, a personal word, a personal touch, and a personal invitation to come along on the journey to God's heart. And now I pray that all of you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with the fullness of God on this holy Easter morning. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter, and God bless each one of you. Amen.
Before we sing the song, the chorus is very simple. It just says, "We sing hallelujah." If you know the song, feel free to sing and worship along with us. If you don't and you just want to lift your hands in praise, do that, for he is worthy of our praise. Amen.
Sing.
the wonderful day to come, when every knee bows before your name. But we will not wait until it's us, for here and now shall your kingdom reign. Oh, 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 we sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing
Please, please feel free to sing along with me with Victory in Jesus.
Hello. All right, everyone, please stand as we sing this song of victory together. Christ the Lord is risen today.
Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. Earth and heaven in chorus say, alleluia. Raise your joys in triumph, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth,
with confidence in the reign of Jesus Christ our Lord. Leave with the blessing that death has been defeated. Leave with the blessing that redemption reigns in your heart, and be bathed in the power of the Holy Spirit. And all God's children said, amen.
Yeah. Morning.
Good morning. Good. Happy New Year.